Boys and girls, this is the Undisputed Era. Adam Cole, Kyle O'Reilly, Roderick Strong, and you're listening to Going In Raw, baby.
This is Shayna Baszler, and you're watching Going In Raw.
This is the knockout artist, Cassius Ohno, and you're Going In Raw.
Hey, friendo, Steve here.
Hey, Larson.
And welcome back to Going In Raw, the only pro wrestling podcast you need to be listening to right here at youtube.com/Steve Larson.
Second of the about the finish of that men's war game match, and yet
that's going to be
a mild coronary for Adam Cole.
I'm going to have a war games dream or nightmare tonight of some sort.
And your dream, though, wouldn't be tables they fall on, but a pit of snakes.
Oh no, that'd be the ultimate war games. Yeah, that'd be terrifying.
With some pineapples thrown in there for good measure. It's everything you don't like.
No, I had a little bit of that pizza stuck in my throat right here.
Some decent pizza.
Yeah. No, that was good pizza.
Good pizza, yeah.
Roma's Pizzeria?
Yeah.
All right, good job. And shout out to DoorDash for being able to deliver to our office.
All right. Just
unlike somebody else.
Let's just get going.
The initials G.
Come on.
Hub. Anyways, oh boy, it's TakeOver. It's TakeOver.
Yeah.
What's the last TakeOver we had?
SummerSlam weekend.
SummerSlam weekend. What was that match? Adam Cole Gargano again? Is that what it was? I don't know. Anyway.
No, that was Cole against... No, because it was Bridgeport TakeOver 25 where Cole won the title. Because it was Johnny and Cole at New York Mania weekend. Gargano won that one.
Okay.
Rematch, Bridgeport.
Yeah.
Cole won that one.
I don't
remember who won. Who
I don't
we faced
anything
it.
About the SummerSlam one. Anyways, this was a load of fun. War Games is truly, you know, man, a lot of people, I'll look it up in a second.
No,
whenever Hell in a Cell.
Talking now. I'll look it up.
Whenever Hell in a Cell comes around, and I don't like comparing things, because apples and oranges, sure, maybe. Whenever Hell in a Cell comes around, what's the main thing? Do we really need Hell in a Cell to be its own pay-per-view?
Yeah, I know.
Shouldn't it be its own special thing that happens? War Games is that...
Yeah, it was. I forgot they had a second 2 out of 3 falls match. That one was one of all the weapons stuff. They took that nasty spot off the top of the cage to finish the show.
What is with Adam Cole? He always scrambles to the top of the cage and nothing good ever happens.
Well, on the Gargano one, it wasn't good for him. It looked like it hurt, but he won the match.
Last year at War Games, it was Ricochet and Adam Cole that came off the top, right?
Well, Ricochet did I don't know how many times he rotated in the air.
Yeah.
Like
a 1080 or something.
Yeah,
like
more
that.
Than that. Yeah. It was a ton. Yeah. He did that off the top of the cage. That was a high spot. And the year before that.
And then they won. The Faces won last year, didn't they? Okay.
Yeah.
Undisputed Era needs to stop. No wonder they're terrified when they say War Games. The year before that, they won.
Yeah, they won the initial NXT War Games bout.
All right. Anyways, this was who's up in predictions points? Predictions
I am right
points.
Now.
By how many?
2.
Did we both call for Undisputed Era?
Uh-huh.
Okay. But you got Pete Dunne.
Yeah.
That lost me 1.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, fair enough. Anyways. War Games is that special time of year. It really is.
Mm-hmm.
Tonight, I honestly don't know. I don't know what match of the night was. I really don't know. That women's war game match.
I'm going to give the edge to that one.
Right? I think so.
Because from top to bottom, start to finish, that was intense. There was a lot of great story. Let's just say that wasn't storytelling in any of the other matches. That one, just from the very beginning, they started off with Io and Candace. They don't like each other.
Well, even.
There was turns.
Yeah.
There was arrogance. Hubris,
yeah.
Handcuffs,
yeah.
Really creative finish,
yeah.
Whereas the main event, the men's War Games match, was good. It was brawl heavy.
Oh, don't just say good.
It was really good.
Gives a little bit of short.
It was
shrift,
really good,
man.
It
was a great match.
It was a great match,
bar had been set so.
Let me finish. It took a little while to get going.
Okay, sure.
Whereas I feel like the women's match started hot right out of the gate because you had two people in the ring that did not like each other.
There was, I see what you're saying. There was nothing not compelling about from the beginning to the end of the women's War Games match. And although the men's one had a second half that is just absolutely killer.
It's bonkers insane, yes.
It took a little while to get there.
It took the scenic route to get there.
Yeah, sure.
A little bit. Yeah. And then while, like, not to get into it yet, we'll talk about it more later. While something huge would happen, like, oh, awesome, there'd be a bit of a lull.
Yeah.
And then something huge would happen, bit of a lull.
Yeah.
Where I felt like especially the end of the women's match was just... Mm-hmm. I mean, there's just so much that went on during the course of it. That would get my edge for the match of the night.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with that. And not to take anything away from the other matches that happened. Mm-hmm. I do feel I feel like Riddle Balor probably was a really good TV main event. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure it was a takeover. Did Balor? I know Balor had. Yeah, Balor had some. I was trying to think around the time. Like, I don't know what the star rating was for like Balor versus Samoa Joe, for example.
Well,
I know
they were really good matches.
Is that the one where he got busted open? Mm-hmm. That was a really good match, but mainly because of the story beat of the being cut open thing.
Yeah.
But not to say that Balor can't put on a 5-star match. I just, this wasn't it. And this probably would, in my opinion, out of all these matches, this is saying a lot. It's a good NXT TV main event because those main events kill these days. They really do.
It's hard. Even the triple threat match, which is really good. I mean, it's hard to compare to a really well booked, well,
that's probably
war
also,
games
that would probably also be
really, what they should just do is have just 3 war games matches on at war games. Just call it a day.
Yeah.
Men, women, tag teams.
Oh my God.
Give me about 45 minutes, including interested and everything there. You got your 2.5 hour show.
Yeah.
Wow. More or less.
That'd be good. Regardless, it was all good stuff.
Yeah, it was all good stuff. Nothing to complain about. There's actually a kickoff show match this time around for TakeOver, a first, since they can't tape stuff ahead for TakeOver recap episodes.
Yeah.
Those are the thing of the past for the most part.
Yeah.
So we got Angel Garza versus Isaiah Swerve Scott.
Uh-huh.
Now, I was expecting this match to start maybe like 15 to the hour.
Yeah.
And I walked in about then, and I caught like the last 3 minutes of it.
Yeah. You didn't really miss a lot. This wasn't even close to Angel Garza's match against Lio Rush. Wasn't even close. Not to say it's a bad match. It's a good match. And the thing that I like about it most is that Angel Garza is on a winning streak.
Yeah, man.
And he is terrific. Not taking anything away from Swerve. He's going to be a big star. But Angel Garza, I'm glad that they like him.
Mm-hmm.
They're giving him good wins.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of them. They had him kick out of Isaiah Scott's finisher, which I forget what it's called. Do you remember what it's called?
I remember what it's called.
It's a cool, like,
house call.
He jumps up and he freaking
the back
kicks.
Kick thing. I think it's called like house call or something like that.
It's a beautiful move.
It's great.
He's a wonderful wrestler.
Garza kicked out of that, and then there was this moment where they both kind of pinned the ref in the corner, and so Garza goes for a low blow. Swerve catches his foot. He tries to kick Garza. Garza blocks that, gives Scott a knee, and then hits the wing clipper for the win.
Mm-hmm, yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah. Push. We're in the midst of a solid Angel Garza push.
I hope so. Yeah, absolutely. And then, boo, backstage earlier, Mia Yim was attacked. She was attacked by somebody. She was being loaded up into the ambulance. Dakota Kai, wearing NWO pants.
Yeah, man.
Mind you. Was helping to load her in. Looked like she was like, hey, I'm going to go with her.
If that's not a tell, I don't know what is.
And then Rhea Ripley, maybe not noticing that she's wearing NWO pants, said, hey, you're in this match. And Dakota Kai's like, I'm not prepared for this. And Rhea Ripley's like, you've been preparing for this your whole life, ever since Shayna Baszler started bullying you back
now
18 years ago.
Now is the time for you to step up to Shayna.
Yeah.
And stand by our side.
Yeah.
In war games.
Yeah, in war games. And she's like, sure, I'll stand by your side.
Here, let me go put my gear on.
Yeah.
First, let me take off these NWO pants I'm wearing.
Right, exactly. So, that happened. And of course, Twitter just lights up. Oh, it was Dakota Kai that beat her up. Anyways.
Yeah, of course it was. So that kicked off the show.
War games.
Team Rhea versus Team Shayna. You had Io and Candice in there to start, which is great. Because this is like a blood feud. They hate each other.
Yeah.
And it's fantastic.
This first bit was great, where Io avoided a suicide dive from Candice. And then she had Candice in the middle. And of course, she uses those ring ropes to do two.
Oh, yeah. It wasn't suicide dive out of the ring. It's suicide dive from one ring to the other ring.
Yeah. And then she gets Candice. She like stops one of them, kicks Candice in the head. She lands in the middle. And so Io then goes and does one 619, hops the other side, does another 619.
Yeah.
It was fantastic.
Yeah. And so Io more or less has the upper hand until the next participant enters, that being Bianca Belair.
Mm-hmm.
The heels take control. They keep control pretty much until Rhea comes in. She sees that her team's at a disadvantage. Both Tegan Nox, well, mostly Tegan Nox, is like, you get in there.
Yeah.
You get in there.
So, what does she do immediately? She doesn't enter the ring immediately.
She brings in the weapons, garbage cans, chairs, kendo sticks.
More garbage cans.
More chairs.
More chairs. So she loads, and the crowd starts chanting for tables, but that's saved for another match, another time.
Well, she goes in the ring, and she hears it, she says, I don't need any tables.
Yeah.
But that was after she already slammed Bianca Belair's head into the door of the cage.
Yeah. Because she's there getting weapons. You're right. Then Bianca tries to like go out there, and it just slams her.
Slams the door.
Yeah, that was great.
And then once in, Rhea drops Bianca with a face buster on a trash can. She sets up some chairs. There's some, maybe a suplex here. It doesn't happen. Anyways, Kaylee Ray's in next. She grabs more chairs. She teases tables, but no.
They know, man, them freaking UK kids, they have been wrestling. Let's say they're in like their, whatever, mid-20s or whatever. I know early 20s. They have been wrestling since they've been like 8 years old.
Yeah.
They know how to work this crowd. That's why Rhea Ripley is so good. It's because she commands whatever space she's in. It's
she
fantastic.
Carries herself like a star.
And Kaylee Ray as well.
Yeah. So, yeah, she brings in more chairs. She teases tables. No. So she gets in there. She takes a chair to Candace and Rhea. Tornado DDT on Rhea on the chair. Again, they tease moves onto the chair. They do finally hit a Tower of Doom on there.
Yeah.
Candace gets that bad.
Her head hit that chair.
Yeah. Dakota is out of the cage next. She maybe makes, I don't know, like 5 paces out of the cage before she turns around and just kicks Tegan Nox square in the head.
And then just annihilates her.
Throws her around the shark cage, rams her into one of the bars of the cage, slams the door in her head, then starts going after the bad knee, slams the bad knee in the door, starts taking her knee brace off, and Regal comes out. It's like, hey, stop it. She pushes him.
She shoves him. Yeah, that was great.
So she's like, all right, done. She goes backstage. She comes running back out.
Yeah.
Attacks Tegan some more, puts a heel hook on her.
Yep.
Tegan's done. Not in the match.
I'm going to monitor. So Rhea Ripley was supposed to be on, on a Facebook thing.
Oh, yeah.
Afterwards with Rhea Ripley. So it has not been announced yet.
Okay.
Who the actual team, because you got to think. You got to think, but before the end of this recap is done, we'll know.
Yeah, they'll officially announce it.
Yeah.
So Shayna's in the cage. She's the last one in team Shayna's cage, and she's just watching all this, and she's loving it.
Yeah.
Just loving it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that was great.
And so she gets out, and she's like all checking on Tegan and laughing. And
laughing.
Counting
pointing.
On her hands. Yeah. Oh, we have the advantage, 4-2. It was great. She goes down in the ring. She produces some handcuffs. And then and one half of the ring gets it on. She eventually gets one of them on Rhea, and then the other half, the other ring. Candace is dropping Kaylee Ray and Io with a double DDT after they try to do a double suplex on her. So Baszler has one of the handcuffs on Rhea's wrist. Is trying to get it to the rope. Candace breaks that up. Rhea tosses Belair into a couple of garbage cans. Fights off a tornado DDT from Kaylee Ray. Suplexes her into the cage. And then Rhea's in one cage in the far corner, with a reverse cloverleaf on Io.
Great. This is really good.
And so Shayna grabs Candace, puts her in the clutch, and is like, all right, who's going to tap first?
Mm-hmm.
Who's going to tap first?
And they're
first?
Just staring at each
other. Yeah, they're just staring at each other, totally. Candace escapes, and then Ray breaks up the cloverleaf. And then Candace tosses Shayna off the top rope. Follows with a lion salt. She goes for the pin. Bianca breaks it up with a garbage can.
There were so many clever garbage can uses in this match. In this match. It was fantastic.
Ray then hits a gory bomb on Candace, and Io follows with a moonsault. Rhea breaks up that pin, and then Candace gets a kendo stick, which nobody really used at that point. Takes out Bianca Belair with it. Io drops her with a backbreaker, and then Io starts climbing the top of the cage.
Yeah.
And so Candace kind of comes to enough. She starts climbing up after her.
Mm-hmm.
And then Kaylee Ray climbs up there too.
Mm-hmm.
So Candace and Kaylee Ray are kind of going at it. And then Candace hits a poison Rana off the top rope.
Yeah.
So she's on, like, Kaylee Ray standing on the top rope. Candace is on her shoulders.
Yeah.
She pushes off from the cage. Poison Rana. Insane.
Just beautiful.
Bianca breaks up that pin. And then Candace and Bianca are kind of brawling. Io stands up. Walks a little bit out from the corner of the ring on the top of the cage.
Yeah.
Hits the moonsault.
So that takes out herself, one of her teammates. One of her other teammates is already down, and Candice LeRae.
Yeah.
So that only leaves Rhea Ripley and Shayna Baszler for this finish, which was great.
So everybody's laid out. Rhea's the first one up. She takes a chair to Shayna, sets up a couple chairs so they're set up facing each other, puts a garbage can on top. Kaylee Ray tries to sneak attack Rhea Ripley off the top rope. She just turns around and throws a garbage can at her.
Yeah.
That was great.
Yeah. Midair.
Yeah, midair. And so that allows Shayna to get the clutch on. And so she's got the clutch on, the grapevine on. So Rhea grabs one hand, tries to power out, can't do it. Grabs Shayna's other hand, and then handcuffs her to herself.
Yeah.
So they're joined at the wrist.
So Rhea's now handcuffed, to Shayna. And the framing is great, too, because when Rhea attains that power, she's standing up and Shayna's still kind of down. So you see that the tables
are totally... power dynamic, totally.
Exactly, yeah.
And so they're trading some blows. Rhea's, I think, on her knees. Shayna tries to kick her. Rhea ducks it right into pump handle position.
Uh-huh.
Riptide onto the two chairs to get the win.
Oh.
Really awesome, really creative finish.
Oh.
Rhea's going to be a massive star.
Yeah. Let's see here. Let's see if there's any update on that. Even Triple H, the last note I saw from Sean Rossap's Twitter update was Triple H says that Rhea Ripley is the future of the wrestling industry. That is totally true, man. Mm-hmm. She's going to main event WrestleMania one day.
I would not be surprised.
Yeah. That it was just terrific. There was also a really great reaction shot of Shayna, like a couple minutes after the finish of the match, just slumped over, eyes barely open.
I know, it was great. There's a lot of great reactions at the end of that match.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
It was fantastic.
Yeah.
Hell of a match.
This next match was good. Damian Priest, Killian Dane, Pete Dunne. This winner gets a shot tomorrow at Survivor Series at Adam Cole.
What's left of Adam Cole.
Who said, would you say that? Adam Cole comes out with rib tape, just kicks him square in the nuts, disqualification.
Oh, yeah, someone in chat.
Somebody in chat said that.
Our reaction stream said that, yeah.
Yeah, walks out with his title DQ.
Yeah, that's how it should be.
And I mean, not to say
just
that.
Just look at Pete Dunne do this.
Yeah.
Give him the Pete Dunne shrug.
Give him the Pete Dunne shrug, exactly.
This was a really fun match, especially the second half of it was bonkers.
It was.
Unfortunately,
just,
I missed much of the first half wondering where our pizza was.
Yeah, there was like phantom ghost pizza smell in the hallway. Our guy came to the door, got, I don't know, social anxiety all of a sudden and ran away.
I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened.
That was our first pizza. Our second pizza actually came. It was delicious. Anyways. But yeah, it was just this was nobody really had for a sustained amount of time the upper hand in this match.
Yeah.
It was just boom, 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 boom. Every guy was hitting, like, there were multiple, I don't know how many Ulster plantations there were. I know there was at least
one. There was one that was hit in one attempt, I believe.
Yeah.
There was a bunch of razor's edges, though.
There was a ton of razor's edges.
A bunch of sentons.
One of those was great. I don't know if you were in the, you weren't here, but one of those was really good because, like, Dane was laid out. Priest and Dunne go to the outside. Priest gets Dunne into Razor's edge position. And then he has to make a decision. He turns towards the apron, and then he looks over to the announce table, and that's where he drops
him. That's cool.
It was good stuff.
That's cool.
It was a very creative match.
Yeah, everything about it was really creative. It was fast paced.
Yeah.
And it looked like it. Like Pete Dunne looked beat up afterwards.
Yeah, he did. Yeah.
He looked beat up.
Yeah, there's been like a couple dudes. Like, there was one bit where... I think like Dunne and Damian Priest were going at it. And then there's all sorts of fun splashes. But then Dane just came in and like basically barreled into Pete
chop
Dunne.
Blocked, yeah.
And it looked like there's a couple times when like stuff looked bad.
Yeah.
Like Dunne started clutching his knee. There was one in the men's War Games match, like
Bobby Fish. Roderick Strong got tossed into the rest of the Undisputed Era and landed on...
There was a one point when
Bob Fish's leg, it looked like.
Dijakovic started grabbing his knee.
Mm-hmm.
That's always the worst because you never know. But then you see him stand up and they're fine.
Yeah. Yeah.
But anyways, let's see here. For this finish, Killian Dane went for a one-winged angel or Ulster plantation. Dunne transitioned to a sleeper hold. Dane hits a senton on Priest, who is already down.
While Dunne's still on his back.
Yeah. Which is a great move because he leaps over Priest to get a senton.
I know. And then Pete Dunne pushes Dane out of the ring and covers Damian Priest for the win.
Mm-hmm.
I guess the idea is that he had the sleeper on long enough that Killian Dane started to fade.
Yeah.
But it was a pretty brutal match, the chop block. There was all sorts of stuff, man. There were a couple times where I was like, dang, someone just got hurt.
Yeah.
Someone just got hurt. But thankfully, no one got hurt. Hopefully.
Then it was announced, TakeOver Portland announced for February 16th.
That's a Sunday. And I think that's President's Day weekend.
And
that's when I speculated they'd have the next AEW show.
Yep.
So congratulations, Portland.
Joshua Martinez, gets to go. Yeah, that should be good. I love that. I love that they're taking it out of what's up.
Oh, never mind. Yes, that's right.
I love that they're taking it out of, or at least this one is out of the Big Four rotation.
So I kind of wonder if they're going to do a thing where ABC at Survivor Series NXT titles being defended on the main, the main card. If that's going to be the new norm for the major four pay-per-views, they'll at least get an NXT title defense on it.
I'd like that.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like that a lot.
And not necessarily tie takeovers to those Big Four pay-per-views.
Well, I mean, look, obviously the downside to that is they're not going to have the allotted time to put together takeover level matches.
But we're still going to have takeovers. We're not getting rid of takeovers in lieu of that. So.
And we'd still have takeovers. And it would give you something else big to build towards. Mm-hmm. Because then you'd have, you know, it's February. Well, I mean, because what are we in? We're in November. And then February.
Is the next takeover.
But then you never know. They might have a match at the Royal Rumble. Yeah. You know, they might have an NXT title match, or Shayna might defend her women's title. She might defend that against Rhea Ripley at the Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a possibility now. And it's a really smart move because Survivor Series has shown that NXT is the third brand.
Yep.
It is a third brand.
Yep.
And now I think, I mean, if they really want to establish it that way, I think one way to do that is when you bring in new names to the company, debut them on the show that makes the most sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
put them on SmackDown or Raw or NXT. Mm-hmm. Don't have them come through NXT to mm-hmm. get to a place.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, I think that'd be smart. You have more stuff to build to. You get more exposure for NXT. And there's your marathon for catching up to AEW on Wednesdays, I guess.
There you go. Next, we had Matt Riddle taking on Finn Balor. Real. Match starts on the mat. Technical. Wrestling.
Catch as catch can.
Collar and elbow.
Although I think that's something different. As the name dictates, it's just this. It's this for 5 hours.
Yeah, it is. It's just jockeying for position until someone gets the upper hand and move to another equally kind of boring position.
Boring,
I'm sure.
Position, exactly.
The kind of story of this one was Riddle trying to work over Balor's ankle a little bit.
Balor looked great, by the way.
Yeah, man, he's cut.
He looked even more cut.
He's like whatever 10% of his diet was made of carbohydrates, he got rid of that.
He felt you breathing down his neck, man.
Guess so.
Yeah.
I got a long way to go get those Balor abs, man.
Oh, boy. Those things are thick.
Yeah, man. So Riddle gets him into ankle locks, tries to work over the ankle. Balor gets the ropes. But later on, that would kind of play into the story because Balor's running the ropes. He kind of trips himself up like, ow, ankle hurts. Nah, tricked you, Riddle. Drop kick for you. Later on, though, Riddle hits a ripcord knee, goes for a powerbomb. Finn escapes, hits double stomp. Ankle seems to be fine. Then a sling blade. Goes for the shotgun drop kick, which is always the prelude to the coup de grace.
Mm-hmm.
Riddle counters with a spear, then the jackhammer, and gets a solid two count.
So, Rhea Ripley has announced Team NXT is herself, Candice LeRae, Bianca Belair, Io Shirai, and Toni Storm. So Bianca replaced Mia Yim from the other night.
Yeah.
And that's it.
I wonder if he's going to announce the men's team tonight, too.
Be nice.
Ciampa's going to choose his team.
He says, sanity didn't click and fell apart from the inside out and dissolved on the main roster. He kayfabed the end of sanity.
Wow.
He kayfabed the end of sanity.
Wow.
Wow. That's hilarious.
That is pretty funny. Then towards the end, Balor goes for 1916. I'm happy they're making that his finish versus the coup de grace.
And also, sorry, he says Triple H calls Adam Cole the Iron Man of the NXT brand. Thinks Dunn versus Cole could be match of the night at Survivor Series. Don't, man. Just, hey, look, have it be just a standard SmackDown level match.
I don't think Adam Cole would ever be content to do that. He wants to be the guy out there that's stealing the show.
No, that's why he's Wrestler of the Year.
He is Wrestler of the Year. So Balor sets up for 1916. Riddle reverses that into a bro to sleep. Then goes up top, tries for the corkscrew splash. Finn gets his knees up. He hits the shotgun drop kick. That means, okay, coup de grace on the way. No, Riddle moves, puts the bro mission on Balor. Balor fights out surprisingly fairly easy. It was kind of great, though, but as he's getting up, Riddle just tosses in a kick to his face for good measure.
Yeah.
But in the end, Balor hits 1916 for the win. Cool, they're bringing back the Prince Devitt finisher now that he's returned to NXT rather than doing the coup de grace.
I agree totally. I said this a couple, I don't know, like a month ago or something. We were talking about Matt Riddle. And I do think that he is one guy who doesn't get hurt at all by high-profile losses. And in fact, if he does go on to win that NXT championship, it's going to mean even more.
Because he's overcome.
Because he's overcome. Exactly.
Yep.
It's going to mean even more. And Balor needed this win.
Yep.
For his re-debut, for his Kalibak re-debut.
Re-debut.
Exactly.
Re-debut.
Yeah.
All right, and that brings us to our main event. Only four matches on the card. Undisputed Era taking on the team of Keith Lee, Dominik Dijakovic, Tommaso Ciampa, and mystery fourth member.
Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, no spoilers yet, please. So Ciampa.
Big old picture Kevin Owens in the thumbnail.
There you go. Ciampa. He didn't even bother getting near the cage.
Yeah.
He's got a cool mask.
It was, according to Epico, it was a Slipknot-inspired mask.
That could be. I don't know. And he's had that kind of mask on a shirt before. I think one of his Clothesline Apparel shirts had that.
He's maybe.
He said on Twitter, the return of the Psycho Killer tonight.
Yeah. Is that a Slipknot song?
Not that I'm aware of. Then he takes the mask off, and he has face paint on.
Yeah, he looked cool.
He looked amazing.
He looked like Kratos.
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah.
He marches down the ring, and then Roddy's like, all right, I'll start for us, Undisputed Era. So Ciampa tosses his crushed middle ring, goes to Roddy. He's like, all right, pick it up.
Have it. Do it.
And then Roddy picks up. He's like, I don't need this to beat you, and tosses it over the cage.
That was good.
That was pretty great. Plenty of back and forth there. I feel like Ciampa had the upper hand throughout the first 5 minutes or so. Kyle O'Reilly next in. Ciampa fights him off for a bit till KO drops him with double leg takedown, some ground and pound.
Don't get used to calling him KO, my friend.
Oh, yeah, I got to watch which KO I'm referring to at a certain point. And then he starts peppering Ciampa with some kicks. Undisputed Era, they have the numbers advantage. Therefore, they have the upper hand. Next in.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
That's right.
Dominik Dijakovic. He drops Undisputed Era with a bunch of boots. Suplexes Kyle O'Reilly onto Roderick Strong's knee. Goes for a feast your eyes on Roderick Strong. Strong escapes. And Dijakovic just tosses him in the cage three times.
Yeah.
Next, Bob Fish.
Bob Fish is out.
He's in there. He clears house. Redragon hits a high-low.
Did he keep his shirt on the entire time? I
think so. Huh. Hits a high-low on Dijakovic, chasing the dragon on Ciampa. Then we get, bask in his glory, Keith Lee. He's in next. He pretty much immediately, double fun splash to O'Reilly and Fish. And then a slingshot double fun splash to O'Reilly and Fish.
That was great.
However, Undisputed Era gets the upper hand eventually. Dijak starts to make a bit of a comeback. Sorry, Dijakovic.
Yes.
So then now faces have upper hand for the bit. Undisputed Era, they turn the tables. Cole gets out of his cage. He brings in the tables.
Yeah.
There must have been 18 tables in that ring.
Man, he set one up that was right next to the door.
Yeah, he propped it up against the barricade opposite
the
door.
Against the barricade.
And there was at least six or five.
He brought in like five more.
At least five.
Yeah.
Yeah, five.
Yeah.
Five. And so he's about to get in the ring. He's walking on the apron. Ciampa just kicks him right in the face and pushes him out, sends Cole right through the table. And I thought maybe they're going to ride him out of the match for a while because he's got like a singles match. No, Ciampa just picks him up, tosses him right back in the ring.
Yeah. Yeah.
They have advantage. And then we get a stare down, a 3-on-4 stare down. Undisputed Era, they win that thing. And then clock counts down. Buzzer goes off. Everybody turns their attention to the ramp. No. They make you wait.
Yeah, they waited for a while.
They waited for a bit.
Undisputed Era was saying they don't have anybody.
They cut back and forth a little bit.
Yeah.
And then, it's Kevin Owens.
Yeah. Other candidates that we had speculated on, a cleared Velveteen Dream. Evidently still not cleared.
A lot of people were thinking maybe John Morrison.
Hey, listen. It's all slow motion.
Yeah, not him. It's Kevin Owens. It
and
made
then
sense.
Somebody in our chat said that he had heard a rumor that it was going to be Cedric Alexander. Wasn't him. Not sure that would have really gotten a huge crowd response. And then CM Punk, of course.
Yeah, they're in Chicago.
Which would have literally, I can't imagine a louder crowd.
Yeah, like that. It wouldn't have happened.
But that wasn't going to happen.
That wasn't going to happen. According to Punk himself. There's a relationship to reconstitute there, and it may take an eternity.
It's already happened, and it's going to happen at WrestleMania.
Get the hell out of here. So, wisely, they get some close-ups of Adam Cole reacting to Kevin Owens coming down the ring, and of course, he is devastated.
Oh, it's
devastated.
It's just beautiful. It's just beautiful.
Just
to see those guys. And sadly, sadly, I don't think that Kevin Owens is going to stick around because of what happened in the end.
Yes.
We'll get to that in a second.
So Owens is in the ring. He clears house. He powerbombs Bob Fish onto Kyle O'Reilly. Then he turns his attention to Adam Cole. And Adam Cole throws up the Undisputed Era.
Uh-huh.
Kevin Owens is like, I don't know how to do that. Suck it.
Yeah.
Tries to go for a stunner. Cole avoids the first time. He does hit a stunner on him. Roddy breaks up the pin.
Uh-huh.
And so we just get a ton of back and forth between everybody. We mentioned a bit where Keith Lee and Dijakovic toss Roderick Strong and the rest of Undisputed Era.
It's so funny, dude, that like once somebody goes back to NXT, to see people, they all of a sudden you can do other moves there. You know, we got a package pile driver. No, we didn't.
They teased it twice.
He teased it that he was going to go for it.
Yeah.
It was just a more aggressive Kevin Owens.
But there's a couple things that he hasn't done, at least not at main roster
right,
in
yeah.
a while.
Yeah.
Like the pump pedal neck breaker he did.
Yeah, right.
When he came
yeah.
in, there's a couple other things he did. I was like, man, I haven't seen him do that in forever.
Yeah.
It's like he thinks he's in Ring of Honor again.
Mm-hmm.
Because even like when Kevin Owens was in NXT, they weren't letting him go as far with moves then as they do now. You couldn't do Destroyers back when Kevin Owens was in NXT. They weren't doing Destroyers back then.
No, they weren't. You're right. They were not. They were not. No.
Now they'll let him Cole do Panama Sunrise just about anybody.
Yeah.
So anyways, there's a lot of cool stuff. This great bit was great. So after a bunch of brawling, crazy action, Kevin Owens turns his attention to Adam Cole one more time, and they're on the corrugated steel part between the two rings. And so he sets them up for a package pile driver.
Mm-hmm.
Cole escapes the first attempt, so he tries it again. And as he's getting him up, Cole kind of like flips over the back of him, hits a super kick, and then follows with a contested Panama Sunrise right on the corrugated steel.
Like he does it, tries it once, doesn't quite work, tries it again, yeah. and then he powers through.
Oh, man.
Like only they get, because like a Panama Sunrise, obviously, is one guy basically jumping backwards,
yeah,
know. You know?
Yeah.
But like to make it come off like Adam Cole powers it
mm-hmm.
is something else.
Yeah,
it was really great.
Yeah. But there's a lot of other great stuff. The faces set up some tables in the rings, a bunch of brawling, huge top rope fun splash from Keith Lee. And then Owens follows with a top Kyle O'Reilly in this case follows a top rope knee on Keith Lee's leg, mm-hmm. slaps a heel hook on him. Dijakovic breaks it up with a springboard moonsault.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes for the pin. Fish breaks that up with like something off the top rope and hit Dijakovic right in the head, it seemed like.
Yeah.
And then Ciampa hits Fairytale Ending on Fish. Owens follows that with a swanton. And then Cole breaks up the pin with a super kick. But Cole goes to the top rope. Lee kicks him. He's up there acting like he's going to do a Spanish fly at the top rope, which mm-hmm. would be amazing.
Yeah.
Strong breaks that up. He hits Olympic Slam off the second rope on Lee. And then Undisputed Era follows it up with a bunch more offense, pin attempt. Dijakovic breaks it up. After that, mentioned the bit with Kevin Owens
mm-hmm.
and Cole, which ended in Panama Sunrise. And then Undisputed Era sits up a pair of tables near one of the corners. So you know someone's going through it.
Mm-hmm.
After they do that, Ciampa proceeds to basically destroy every member of Undisputed Era not named Adam Cole.
Yeah.
And then Cole hits a super kick on Ciampa. Ciampa kind of shakes it off, tosses him in the cage, followed with a bunch of running knees. Cole comes to enough to try for a Panama Sunrise on Ciampa through the tables. Ciampa fights it off. They start smashing each other's head into the cage.
And then things get really dicey because Adam yes. Cole starts climbing to the top of the cage.
Yeah.
Strong and Fish start focusing on Keith Lee. Ciampa then starts chasing Adam Cole up to the top of the cage.
Yes.
Not good.
But we're not really seeing that. We're just being told that by commentary because we're focusing what's happening on the other cage. So you see Dijakovic choke-slamming Roderick Strong out of one ring into another, then through a table. He teases the same for O'Reilly. Instead, O'Reilly puts a triangle on Dijakovic. Dijakovic powers him up like he's going to power bomb him, but no, he starts to fade.
Fades out.
So
yeah.
He
rests O'Reilly kind of on the table. Kevin Owens sees that, goes up to the top,
frog splash. Yeah.
Frog splash onto that.
And then Keith Lee power bombs Bob Fish at the table because they're still brawling on the top rope too.
Yeah.
And so you got Ciampa and Cole up at the top of the cage in the corner. Of course, you got those two tables right below them. And Ciampa, man, going past why these guys do this, just the level of balance for Ciampa, with Cole's help nonetheless, to hoist Cole on his shoulders and have maybe this much you know, steel or whatever to work with to get your balance on and not the slip, not the fall.
I know.
Not to accidentally mess somebody up real bad.
I know.
And to hit that air raid crash to finish the match is insane.
I know.
Absolutely insane.
Crazy.
And the level of trust these guys have in each other is off the charts.
I mean, that's one thing about – that's one thing that's sort of advantageous about, you know, today's wrestler, they go for a wider variety of character as opposed to just giant person.
Yeah.
And that's one thing about Ciampa and Cole is that they're not the biggest dudes in the world, but they're a lot more maneuverable. And I'm not saying that it would that it's easy at all what they're doing, but it is. You can I think you can tell a wider variety of stories with people that can do
in-ring stories for sure. Yeah,
yeah, in-ring stories that are that with people with guys who are you know more agile. They can you know they're lighter. So yeah, it was just
it was off the charts.
Just
man.
Off the charts, great. Just really terrific.
I
did,
fun show.
Yeah, I did put up a and then at the end, in the end,
yes.
Team NXT stand tall. Kevin Owens goes over to Ciampa, says maybe
probably thanks,
thank
good
you,
job.
Something like that.
Leaves the ring less
and
than.
Then he leaves very quickly and lets Team NXT. So I mean, look, tomorrow Kevin Owens is going to be part of Team Raw. I would imagine they're going to commentary is going to bring up, well, Kevin Owens is on this team, but he was with because I guarantee I don't I'm not sure if they were going to announce it.
Oh yeah,
during
yeah,
this conference NXT, call or not?
The men's team,
right?
I mean, I guess at this juncture, probably the best we can hope for is Adam Cole essentially calling out Kevin Owens on NXT to explain himself, and we get some back and forth.
Okay, so here we go. Sean Ross Sapp, according to this Triple H thing, there isn't any clarity given on whether or not Owens is on NXT full time or his status for tomorrow's pay per view. He says Owens and Balor want to be in NXT to be in there with the best. He doesn't know if Owens will be on Team Raw and doesn't know who will be on Team NXT tomorrow.
Oh, there you go.
I don't know, man. The fact that Kevin Owens has shirts on Pro Wrestling Tees.
Again, yeah.
I think you generally sell less merch if you're in NXT.
Could be.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Although the Undisputed Era sell a lot of merch.
Yeah, they do.
But maybe that's one aspect.
Nakamura sold a ton of merch in NXT.
Yeah, that's a good point. But, you know, he was wearing his duct tape shirt.
And with the NXT logo on back. So one could be hopeful that he'll be back in NXT.
Maybe him leaving early was just to sell the fact that War Games or the Survivor Series is tomorrow. But it's him and Balor. I'd love to see him.
And it could also just be a thing where it's like, okay, maybe it's in the works, but I'm not officially full-time NXT. I was the last man out. These guys are here that busted their tails for the majority of the match. Let's let them get the shine.
Team NXT is going to be revealed tomorrow in the kickoff.
By Shawn Michaels.
Triple H indicated we'll have to wait and see if Kevin Owens is part of or still with Raw. I mean, it's probably, look, man, I always say be prepared to be disappointed.
Yeah.
So he's probably going to just be Team Raw.
Yeah, I know.
But who knows? Maybe he'll swerve Team Raw. I mean, maybe it's been the kind of thing where he says, no, I'm Team Raw. I helped them because I hate the Undisputed Era. They beat me up.
Yes.
That's one-on-one. That's in the past now. I'm fully Team Raw.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're like, oh, what a bummer. Boom, he turns on Team Raw.
Yeah.
And he's that helps NXT get the win because we both have that as the win.
Yep.
And then he's...
For life.
Oh, I hope that's the case.
That'd be great.
That'd
be great. Aaron Gasper, I'm confused. Is Damian Priest a vampire or a Highlander? He's neither. He likes to hit the clubs.
Yeah, he's a club guy who also has a couple of Anne Rice books.
Yeah, yeah. Wolfpack for Life asks, will Team Raw replace Kevin Owens tomorrow for helping Ciampa? Not if they replace him. I don't think they'll replace him helping Ciampa. They may replace him if he steps down.
Oh.
Doesn't show up.
We forgot to mention. After the air raid crash, big old close up of Britt Baker.
And commentary mentioned her by name.
She's a dentist.
I don't think they're going to replace Kevin Owens unless he says, I'm going to NXT, probably in the match. I could be wrong.
They're not going to announce that. You know, that's a big story beat. If he leaves Team Raw for NXT, that's not going to be announced in the
kickoff show.
No, they're not going to do that. So. If anything, if he's going to go to NXT, he's going to be on Team Raw, he's going to turn on
him. It's going to be a dramatic thing, yeah. Just Lucas, kayfabe reason Britt Baker was in the crowd.
Check on people's teeth.
Yeah.
To make sure.
She might wrestle for AEW, but she's NXT's dentist.
Yes, exactly.
James Rodriguez, after tonight, who do you expect to see in the men's team for NXT tomorrow? Well, Ciampa, Lee, Riddle.
Ciampa, Lee, Riddle.
Dijakovic. Those, the four of them, for
maybe,
sure.
Maybe Leo Rush.
Yeah.
Maybe Leo Rush.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
I see that.
That'd be cool.
Randy Quaid.
Oh, you didn't know?
Oh, you didn't know?
Wolfpack for Life, is the flip pile driver becoming overused? So many wrestlers do it. No. I can watch Canadian Destroyers all day.
It's beautiful. It is a beautiful move.
James Uval, book the Dakota Kai NWO faction.
Oh, God. It's just her going around recruiting people and being like, "When have you ever won a match?" People being annoyed with her. Oh, you know who'd be cool? Io Shirai.
Mm-hmm.
Her as like a wild card.
Yeah, she'd be the perfect wild card.
Oh, man. That's good.
One more woman.
Oh, Bianca.
Mm-hmm.
Bianca Belair.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good team.
That would be a good team. Dropkick Sports Entertainment. The only way NXT beats AEW is if NXT brings back all the OGs. They are only missing a few. Yeah, bring Joe back and Nakamura.
Yeah.
Bo Dallas. Ratings draw, man.
How about this? You get rid of Moro. You put Joe in his place at commentary.
Man. Oh, man.
Mama mia, goo. He can do backstage interviews. Oh, here I am with Keith Lee. You're limitless, goo. And he's like, is there a question there?
He gives a good answer. Oh, mama mia. That's his response to interesting answers. Exactly. Lubricant Hornet was there live tonight. Was the smoke bothering anyone else? Didn't notice any smoke.
I didn't notice any smoke.
Andre Zimple. Did you guys think at all that the fourth member would be KO after seeing the ambush this past Monday? I had a feeling it would be him. Yeah, he was a contender.
He was on the list.
Strong contender. Yeah.
He was on the list. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. Like, I'm trying to think who my number one, if it were like, hey, you have to bet all your money on it. I probably would have gone with Dream as being like my number one. Okay, if it's going to be anybody, it's him.
Mm-hmm.
But Kevin Owens was probably my number two.
Mm-hmm.
And then CM Punk.
Oh, God.
No. Anyways, that's it. What a solid takeover.
Fun show. We're going to be back at it tomorrow. Survivor Series starts at 2 p.m. We'll be here sitting back there for the announcement of Team NXT for the Men's Survivor Series match. They announced the pre-show match, so we could just be sitting around here for 2 hours listening to people talk.
Should be a pretty interesting. Yeah, I know. What's up with that? Let's see if there's any last-minute news here.
Unless one of the matches announced so far, they're going to bump to the pre-show, which would be kind of lame.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, nothing else. All right. Anyways, thanks everybody for tuning in. We appreciate it. We'll talk to you guys tomorrow. Until next time, we'll talk to you later.
Goodbye.
Where's the button? Oh, there it is. This one.